Hello and welcome to episode number 285. This is the Project Management Podcast at pm-podcast.com, and I'm Cornelius Fichtner. Glad you could make it. Are you a project manager, or do you consider yourself to be a project leader? And what are the steps in order to go from manager to be more of a leader? My guest today is Sean Dickerson. He is the GTM director for AtTask Incorporated, and AtTask recently published an ebook titled Project Leadership: Lessons from 40 PPM Experts on Making the Transition from Project Management to Project Leadership. And we are going to review what it means to be a project leader. This episode is sponsored by the Agile Prepcast at agileprepcast.com. If you are thinking of becoming PMIACP certified, then why not do what you're doing right now? Use a podcast. Nearly 1,500 project managers so far have used the Agile Prepcast video lessons to prepare for their exam. Give it a try at agileprepcast.com/free. From the ebook introduction, we learn the following. Strong project leadership can make the difference between success and failure. When it comes to project management, we tend to talk about the tactical, the assignments, the tasks, the approvals, and so on. But business is evolving, and many of us are now being asked to lead change instead of just managing timelines and milestones. And this change is not only happening, it's accelerating. So sit back and enjoy our interview on becoming more of a project leader.
The Project Management Podcast's Feature Interview.
Today with Sean Dickerson, Go-to-Market Director for AtTask.
Hello, Sean, and welcome to the Project Management Podcast.
Thank you very much, Cornelius. It's a pleasure to be here.
And it's great to have you. My first question to you, a really simple one, but probably very hard to answer. How do you define project leadership?
It is a big question. It's a question in a lot of people's minds in this industry right now. I would put it like this. I would say that being a project leader is being focused on outcomes instead of milestones. One simple example from the world of marketing might be, you know, there was a time in marketing where we would, you know, produce a slick flyer and assume we had done our job. Well, then as the web came to the fore and we started to be able to really analyze what people were doing and what they were seeing, we suddenly had this whole world opened up to us about, is what we're producing actually effective? Is it really moving the business forward? And to me, that's sort of the essence of project leadership, is less about the milestones, though those will always be important, and more about the ultimate outcome of any given strategic project.
And how then does that differ from the traditional role of what a project manager does?
I think the fundamental difference is in the skill set. A lot of the same metrics will still be important, but there's certainly more of an emphasis on some of the softer skills. I think project leaders have great communication skills, a lot of business savvy. They're able to have conversations about business drivers and the impacts of a given project, as opposed to just, you know, durations and deadlines and so forth. I think there's also a willingness to work with executive stakeholders in their language. In the boardroom, there's more of an emphasis on what does this project actually mean for the business? And I think a project leader is willing and even eager to engage in that. In fact, one simple example is we had one of our business architects out at a large customer recently, and this person was treated to the head of the project management office over there, shared with him the presentation she uses for sort of advocating the work of the PMO, for demonstrating the value of the organization to some of the executive stakeholders. So it was a very interesting discussion, but also an interesting shift from the more traditional world of project management, where some of these leaders are focused on running things like a business and building the value of their organization across the board where they can add value.
Why do you think it is that we see suddenly such a strong focus on us project managers, that we now have to suddenly step up and become project leaders?
I think it's the evolution of the role. You know, the sort of top-down culture, particularly if we look at the IT department, where a lot of folks have project management skills and roles, you know, with the advent of shadow IT, more dollars being spent by each individual business units, the role of a project manager is beginning to shift. And in fact, I attended the Gartner PPM Summit earlier this year, and they gave a great presentation about what project management will look like in 2020. And one of the things that they commented on, and again, this was from a more of an IT perspective, but they said in the future, it's going to be about adding value to the business units, to the projects that need to be executed so that the business can be successful. And by the way, incidentally, I'm in IT or I'm a project manager. It's more about that role evolving to provide value anywhere a strategic effort needs to happen around the organization from a sort of a grassroots approach, as opposed to just a structured top-down, let's get this stuff done.
What would you say is the first thing that someone should do if they are told that they need to get away from being a, you know, a regular project manager, in quotes, regular, of course, and focus more on project leadership?
That's a great question. I think probably the biggest thing, and this isn't really getting to a traditional solution in people's minds, but as we work with customers, I think the very most important thing is to diagnose the problem. And what I mean is, there's an innate desire for every project manager to take that leadership and strategic role. Folks that have that kind of a responsibility at a company are sharp thinkers, results focused, all of those great qualities, and they will gravitate toward the strategic nature of the role. But often there's just sort of tactical things that kind of mire us down. For example, most of us, you know, want to gravitate toward those strategic things, but if the information for a project or the stakeholders in a project are completely disconnected, for example, the status of a project lives in your email box and in a spreadsheet on somebody's local hard drive and in a couple of post-it notes on somebody's desk. If that's where all of this information is being held, then it means that a project manager doesn't have the time to invest in project leadership because they're spending all of their time in the really mundane stuff of hustling around from place to place to gather status updates, attending status meetings, which the stakeholders they're interested in speaking with may or may not be there. In fact, we had one project manager that I spoke with say, look, you know, in the past, the best tool that I had for getting my job done was my shoes, because I have to run all over the place to gather the information that's needed to be able to show progress or answer the questions that are put to me. Even basic questions like, who's working on what? Is it the right stuff? And are we on track? So I really think job number one is sort of diagnosing the problem in that, what is it that we have to do every day that's keeping us from engaging at a more strategic level?
Do you see a difference between leading a small project versus leading a large project?
Obviously, there is nuance that's different between the two. But honestly, I don't see from what I've observed at our customers, I don't see a tremendous difference between large and small projects. The real difference is that when you're leading a large project, the gaps are a lot more obvious. For example, that situation I just described where a project manager is being asked to, you know, run all over the campus gathering updates from a variety of different stakeholders, that problem is somewhat manageable if you're dealing with, you know, a team of 10. Once you're dealing with a project team of 20, 50, 100 that are potentially spread all across the globe, even though fundamentally you're dealing with the same process and the same issues as a small project, those issues are much more glaring because suddenly one person just can't cover all that ground to make it successful. So I think the large projects expose those gaps a little bit more, but fundamentally the process should be the same.
How do you personally lead your teams? What's your leadership approach?
Well, I certainly wouldn't set myself up as the archetypal example of that. But, from my perspective, I focus on a couple of things. One is autonomy and one is accountability. Whether that accountability comes through the vehicle of, a software package, or whether it's, transparency in a board meeting, whatever the case may be, there needs to be a way that we're held accountable for what we need to accomplish. Preferably, the less manual, the better. But I think to do that, you also need a high degree of autonomy. And obviously, that starts with hiring great people so that some of those elements kind of take care of themselves. When you have the right team, then I think autonomy and accountability are most of what you need to be successful. And then as a leader, removing the roadblocks where they impede progress, whether that is, something just logistical on a day-to-day basis, or whether it's getting strategic alignment on a particular issue that's come to the forefront of what the team is working on. But sort of kicking open those doors is another important part of project leadership.
To properly manage a project in any given organization, you need to have a certain components in place that help you manage, like a methodology or a reporting tool. Are there any components that are indispensable for leading a project?
Yeah, I think there are a few. Just hearkening back to that earlier example, I would say possibly number one on that list is a single source of truth for project information. Now, obviously, AtTask has solutions in this arena, but it really doesn't matter whether we're talking about any particular product, as long as there's an agreement on what that single source of truth is. For some smaller organizations, they've said, look, this all requests go in through this Google Doc, and nothing is done unless it comes through that path. That's really what's important. Each organization can figure out the mechanics of what that single source of truth looks like. Obviously, it becomes more complex as the organization gets larger. But having that is key. Having a single consolidated place where work requests can come in, a place where stakeholders can see real-time reports on what is occurring and what the status is, and a place to make assignments that follow a certain workflow that conforms with an organization's policies and procedures. And I start there because when those things are in place, or I should say when those things aren't in place, then a project manager is going to spend almost all of her time on tactical stuff, on trying to get people in a room for a status check, on trying to get folks to respond to emails that are buried in an inbox with 200 or 300 unopened messages, leaving voicemails, post-its, whatever the case may be. Without that single source of truth for project information, it becomes a very manual process to keep a project moving forward that really doesn't allow, even if the project manager is inclined to be a more strategic project leader, they simply don't have the time to do so. And one other thing that I would add to that is a common place to collaborate in the context of work. We find that to be very important. There are a lot of services that companies use to collaborate, whether it's email or instant messaging or an enterprise social network. The more closely attached those services are to the actual work that needs to get done, the more successful they'll be, the more engaged users will be. Now, it's one thing to set up an internal social network and just ask people to start talking about things. It's quite a different to have a conversation around a specific task that's noted within the context of that collaboration, where all team members can see a historical record of the conversation that's been had and so forth. So that commonplace to collaborate in the context of work, I would say, is another element or another component of leading a project.
You work for AtTask, and your company provides cloud-based project management software. So the obvious question here, of course, has to be this. How can project management software, whether it's in the cloud or not, help me to become a project leader?
Well, thanks for asking. I have to say, when we refer to the solution that we offer, we actually use a different term. We talk about it in the context of enterprise work management. Now, strategic projects are definitely a part of that, but they're just one element. So what do we do specifically for project managers is we eliminate that work chaos that keeps project managers from being project leaders, that forces them to spend time, too much time in the tactical, because they're doing those mundane and manual things that don't allow them to focus on the strategic. Our approach is that a solution needs to take a more holistic view of work, that it needs to look at the entire life cycle of work. For example, you could be as efficient as you want at executing planned projects, but if you're not taking into account the unplanned work, the ad hoc work that, according to some studies, makes up 50% of our days, then those strategic projects are going to get derailed every time. So we try to take a holistic look at planned and unplanned work so that you can actually get a clear picture of what needs to be done. We try to look at different methodologies as well. We have a number of customers who use us for a sort of linear waterfall method, project methodology, and others that use us in an agile, using an agile approach. So bringing together not just the different types of work, but also the different methodologies used to execute that work. And then finally, as I was mentioning, we try to look at the entire life cycle of work from initial request to final report. Because if you're not addressing that whole life cycle, you're simply introducing more complexity into the process, more tools that need to be integrated or manually or data manually moved from one place to another, introducing error and so forth. And the last thing that we try to do is deliver it with a user experience that's simple enough so that anybody can engage, from the most technical of project leaders to the most, I guess I'd say, untechnical of business stakeholders.
So a little bit tongue-in-cheek here, but do you think there will ever be a time when software companies like AtTask will rebrand their tools and call them project leadership software?
It's not a bad idea. It's not a bad idea. I think that's definitely the way the industry is heading. But I think a result of that is really trying to take that more holistic view of work. So I think you're going to see a lot more emphasis on things like collaborative work management and areas like that.
Yeah, and one thing that I just realized and quickly want to touch upon here is why we're actually talking about this shift from project manager over to project leader. AtTask has published a ebook. It's called Project Leadership: Lessons from 40 PPM Experts on Making the Transition from Project Management to Project Leadership. And that was actually the original reason why you got in touch with me and wanted to do the interview. So I'll make sure that we have a link to that ebook in the show notes so that our listeners can get to this. And there are a ton of good people here. I recognize a few faces here on the front page. Margaret Maloney is there. Ricardo Viana Vargas is there. Rich, now, of course, I look at the face, I recognize it, but I can't think of the name.
And I'm probably not as familiar with all 40 contributors. So, yes, you got it right there. I think the interesting thing to note, and just to encourage folks to download that piece, it's by no means a sales pitch for AtTask, but really the advice of a lot of these industry experts. And I think it's interesting that it's been, for AtTask, our most successful ebook ever in this area, I think because it's so packed with great insights.
Yeah. Rich Maltzman it is, by the way. I just figured out his name. All right. Moving on. As a general rule, project management can be taught, but it's a bit more difficult to teach project leadership in a classroom environment. What type of training approaches do you see in your customers' organizations to help support the transition from being a manager to a leader?
I think the most important thing is to run it like a business. When you think about strategic project management or project leadership, your stakeholders are customers. There are particular measures or outcomes that are valuable, not just to the project itself, but to the business. And so when we approach project leadership like its own business, and we are trying to effectively move forward a business unit or a strategy, I think that represents a shift in thinking that helps project leaders be much more effective. Also, you know, going back to an earlier point, diagnosing where time is spent so that you can overcome any obstacles that are there, and just rejecting the status quo in general. I think some of the best project leaders that we see are willing to speak up regarding things that aren't effective or that need to be altered for not just to hit a milestone, but to make a project or an initiative very meaningful to the business.
Let's close the interview with a few tips. We've already spoken about the first step that people should take when they switch from being a manager to a project leader. So what are your top three recommendations on what any and all of us can do in order to make that switch, to go from being a quote-unquote simple project manager to being a project leader?
I would say number one, and we touched on this previously, is really remove the roadblocks to achieving that status by understanding where time is being spent. If you're coming in each week with an idea of what you want to accomplish, and that is very quickly derailed by hours of status meetings and fire drills and pulling together reports and spreadsheets and searching through your email box for a status update that somebody sent 3 months ago, those are the type of obstacles that are going to, no matter what your designs or desires are, that are going to make it impossible to find the time to be a strategic project leader. So that's number one. Number two is to really communicate at a business level, to have conversations at a business level. For example, if you think about project managing the new product development process, there's a number of milestones in there, delivery dates that are important to the project. But ultimately, if you look at it altogether, it's about time to market. How effective can we be to beat the competition with a new product to market, or to get it to market so that we don't miss a particular buying season? When we can communicate at a business level on those topics, I think that speaks volumes about that strategic leadership role. And finally, I would just say, similar to number one, is remove the information silos. We've talked to so many organizations where just essential project information is in somebody's notebook in their second desk drawer. If that project information is stored in all of those disconnected places, it's impossible to be an effective manager, let alone strategic leader. So you have to tear down those information silos as another key for making that shift from simple project management to project leadership.
Great. And before we go, let me just repeat the title of the ebook that AtTask has published. It is called Project Leadership: Lessons from 40 PPM Experts on Making the Transition from Project Management to Project Leadership. Thank you so much for your time today, Sean.
It was my pleasure. Thank you very much.
And that was Sean Dickerson on how we can all become more of a project leader and less of a manager. And that's it. Thank you very much for listening. As always, you could find us on the web at pm-podcast.com. Please send your emails to info@pm-podcast.com. And when you write, please tell me where in the world you are writing from. And finally, we have this. It takes half your life before you discover that that life is a do-it-yourself project. Until next time.